four, three, two. Well, welcome everybody. Welcome to this morning safari and the bushwalk for the sunrise, which was actually quite beautiful a couple of minutes ago and has now disappeared behind a cloud bank. I'm Stefan Winterboer and you are at Juma Private Game Reserve here in the Kruger National Park, and we have Andrew on camera with me today and Lou and Tara that are in the final control at the moment. Mind blank at the moment. Excuse me, the wind on the rush out here today seems to have blown my brains away. But just for those of you who are watching last night, a little bit of an update about the vehicles at the moment. We managed to resurrect Jigger from the ashes. She got back from town last night, and we'll be up and running with James and Brian, hopefully in a couple of minutes as well. But until that happens, you are with us, and we are on safari in the far eastern side of Juma Private Game Reserve, close to Cheetah Cutline. And standing on top of a termite mound at the moment because we seem to be having a few signal problems and lots of hippo, lots of their tracks at least anyway. I heard this area is actually quite good for elephant, for rhinoceros and for buffalo, but I'm here this morning because it's also place to find lion, and I'm hoping that we get a chance to see these Birmingham boys. I haven't seen them for ages, and this is one of the better areas to have a look for where they come into and come out of our property. I did see some water buck. There were some water buck sleeping here just now as we managed to stop. This side, Andrew, you're gonna get caught up in a tree. Andrew's carrying this big backpack on his back with an eagle, and what we've got to try and do is make our way through these trees and meander through all these things and not get him caught. It's quite cold this morning. For those of you who are watching the show last night and yesterday, you would have noticed we had quite a bit of rain, and it's about 56 degrees Fahrenheit at the moment, or 13 degrees Celsius, which is actually quite cold. But you'll see I have my sleeves done. But we'll warm up quite quickly walking around. It is always when you are walking through the bush to temperatures. So we've come up to an open clearing in front of us, and what's immediately apparent right here on the game path in front of me is a series of tracks from a wildebeest that looks like he's been running. Now, what I'm gonna do is bring you around this side of the track so we can actually go through the sequence with you. I'm gonna show you from this side. You're gonna see Andrew's gonna turn around a little bit. And I want you to have a look and see if you can follow my finger. You'll notice here the animal was running. And you'll see by the freshly kicked up dirt, it's actually not a wildebeest, it's a water buck. And Andrew, come and have a look over here. It's quite interesting. All these animals are cloven-hoofed animals. Now, we'll traditionally think that a cloven hoof is actually quite a stiff thing, and while it is, and its evolutionary adaptation is to make these animals run faster. That is why they developed this cloven hoof, which essentially is, if you have a look at my fingers over here, these animals started with a four-toed foot. It looked pretty much like this. These two toes became vestigial and moved up the leg to become the dew claws. These two toes solidified, becoming essentially big fingernails and allowing the animals to come up onto their toes and walk on their middle two toes. And here we have one toe, and there's the other toe. One toe and other toe. This is the front foot. This is the back foot. And you can see how the hoof is actually split apart and moved slightly deeper, giving the animal traction into this ground, which allowed it to push off and allowed it to generate some decent speed. This water buck was going at a decent clip. If you have a look, and I can have a look at the spray pattern of sand that I have over here, you'll notice that the sand kicked away into an area almost this big. So I would say that this water buck was probably running at pretty close to full speed here. At full speed trot, it's not a full speed gallop. These animals don't gallop the way a horse would, for instance. They've got a funny sort of trotting walk that they do. All right, let's carry on. So Sean, come on Sean. Sean, you've asked me if I'm not afraid of an elephant and wild dog when I'm on foot. Sean, I'd say that I've got a healthy caution for them. I've got a natural respect for their power and their speed, but I'm not scared of them. I've been living for way too long with these animals to be scared. There are situations where you do get scared, and I do get nervous, but I try as much as I can to respect them and respect their space, and in so doing I hope to reciprocate that that notion. Now we have a squirrel that was calling at us as we entered this clearing. The only thing that I can see at the moment is some fairly fresh elephant dung. Now
hello everyone. Being out in the bush and being out there live has its technical challenges. We're experiencing some of that now and are working on it as fast as possible to get it sorted and get you back in the vehicle with us.
Well, welcome back, and I'm gonna say sorry this time for having that picture problem. We are on foot, we are in the middle of an African wilderness, and these things happen from time to time. What I can tell you though is it's the effect of the greening up of the bush that's having an effect on this. Can you believe it? All the leaves and everything coming out in these trees are causing some picture jumps. But no damage done. And we're back with our piece of elephant dung, our elephant bolus at the moment. And I know that this is fairly fresh, A, because you can see it, there's still some moisture on the top. And B, there's not too many flies yet around this piece of elephant dung. There's not too much of anything, not nocturnal insects as well. Now, generally what you do to test how fresh this dung is you kick it open and you test for heat. Now, I'm not touching it, of course, but very little heat. In actual fact, I can almost feel the evening's chill still on it. So this was done sometime during the night and doesn't mean that I have to look up at the moment and expect an elephant trunk to come and tap me on the head, which is a good thing. But it does mean that we have some elephant in the area. Now, we have got squirrels busy alarm calling quite vigorously in front of us, and I want to go and have a look at what they're alarm calling for. We are on a rise, and this is birds of prey start their morning forays from as well, because you're going to have wind that comes off of these high areas, and with the dip it allows the birds to gain some height. Now, for those new to the show, you'll see that I do carry a rifle. It's just basically a piece of safety equipment, essentially for the cameramen more than anything else, because they are less mobile than what we are. And you might be wondering and asking yourself the question, why do you not see James and Brent and Scott carrying the rifle? And the answer is quite simple, in that in South Africa it's quite difficult to get a weapons license, and simply I've just been operating on foot professionally for longer than what they have, and it's been one of those essential pieces of kit basically that I've had to get. Equally so, Brent and Scott have armed themselves with their cameras. I don't have a camera. And that has been how they've generated a living over the last couple of years. Now, I don't actually want to go this way. I want to go into the bush over here. Andrew's busy scanning and showing you how wide open it is. We're coming to the end of this plain here. And the squirrel in question is calling from that tree there. I think let's go and have a look. Ah, Lucy's asked the inevitable question, what do I carry in my backpack? Lucy, I enjoy carrying a backpack. I have water in my backpack. I have a first aid kit in my backpack. I have a variety of paraphernalia in my backpack, including, believe it or not, even a sewing kit in case I lose a button and need to sew it on in the bush. But as ridiculous as that sounds, I'm quite fastidious when it comes down to that, and don't enjoy having buttons going missing, etc., etc. I also have a pair of binoculars in my backpack. And what else do I have in my backpack? That's probably it at the moment. Oh, I've got some waterproof bags in case it starts raining and we need to put the camera into my backpack to keep it safe. The camera is not waterproof. Let's go here. This is a caterpillar pod. Now, evidence of elephant that have been foraging on this particular tree. I love this tree. It grows on the fringes of these open areas quite successfully and is used as an aphrodisiac by the local Shangaan people. Called a caterpillar pod because it gets a hairy seed pod towards Christmas time. And some lions roaring in the distance. Unfortunately, they are a little bit too far away for you to hear. I would judge them to be at least 4 or 5 miles away. So at least we got my answer about where these Birmingham boys seem to be this morning. Definitely not anywhere close to where I am at the moment, unfortunately. Anyway, back to our caterpillar pod. So elephant do feed on caterpillar pods. This particular caterpillar pod, I fear, has been damaged beyond repair. I see that its rootstock has been completely stepped on by this elephant. This elephant stepped on this tree, and I know he stepped on this tree because I'm seeing all these crushed leaves right here and here that look like he's pushed the tree down and then stepped on it. For whatever reason, probably to get some roots down here. Naughty elephant. I don't enjoy it when they kill these trees, even though that's their primary function. Elephants are what are known as keystone species. Sorry, it just looks like I've got some elephant in the distance there, which is a good thing. Let's go and have a look. Elephants are known as keystone species, which mean that they are one of those animals that can actually affect great change in the bush around you. It is because of them that a lot of other animals and plant communities, entire ecosystems in actual fact, thrive. Without elephant, systems tend to not be as healthy and not be as robust. Doesn't mean that they'll collapse, it just means that they won't be as good as what they could be. Now, as far as I can define it, elephant, their role is to counteract Mother Nature's growing plus, or trees really battle to to control themselves. They can grow, they do grow, and they proliferate. Elephant come along and open up the canopy, make sunlight reach the ground, make it easier for different types of plants, not just the big bushed canopy trees, to thrive. And of course that then in turn supports a massive variety of animals, plants and insects as well. Chacha, Andrew, you're gonna spike yourself. I love these little places. This here, we're standing on a spring. Now the springs in this place are not really origin points for water. It's not like some water gushing out of a rock or points in a rock into a sparkling pool. It's more like a seep. It's a spongy area that water just constantly pours out in summertime. And this is where it'll start to form its first drainage line. This is one of the, as you can see on the edge of this elephant path, this is where the first water will collect and the first small streamlet will appear. And they will appear here. This will start running, probably it'll be pretty much full flow by January or February. And where we're standing now is where that water starts to come out of the ground. And it collects on the crests. Just busy listening to the bush around us. So I was just listening for those elephants. Doesn't seem like they're too close, seems like they're moving across. But what rain does is it falls over the entire area. The crests of these hills over here are predominantly sandy. The sand absorbs the water. More water then falls in our high rainfall months. That water then puts pressure on the water in the ground, and it starts to seep out when it hits rocks. And this is that seep. This is where we're seeing those seeps happen. That's basically what happens over here from a water point of view. Let's carry on going. And while we walk, I'm going to answer Jilly's question. And good morning, Jilly, all the way from Milwaukee. If I were stuck out here in the bush, what would I use to eat? Where would I find shelter? Where would I find water? That's a good question, Jilly, because it's actually not such an easy thing to do. We are so dependent on supplies. I would say that we've actually lost the ability to survive indefinitely and survive well out here. Even with 20 years almost of bush experience, I don't know if I'll be able to do it for an extended period of time and not be affected negatively at all. Seasonally, you do have bushes that provide fruit and can provide you with some sustenance. Water wouldn't be too difficult to find, however, good quality water would be difficult to find. And in terms of shelter, that's fairly simple. But in terms of good shelter that offers you decent protection from wild animals, particularly hyena and lion, you'd have to stay in one area and really give some care and attention to your shelter. So I don't know, I think I'd still say, I'd definitely have to go with the fact that without supplies out here, that it would be a tough thing to do to survive here indefinitely. And you'd probably find that being nomadic would be the answer, at least until you could get to a settlement where many people can help with different tasks. You wouldn't be able to do it on your own. We've got our first mammal on the path in front of us. We have a zebra. Seen us way before we saw him. And zebra are actually quite alert. It's one of the reasons why zebra and wildebeest hang around together. They eat different parts of the same grass. A wildebeest likes to eat the top of the grass and zebra like to crop the bottom, so they follow one another around. So that helps the zebra. the wildebeest benefit from the zebra's vigilance. I just find them the most bizarre animals. Next to giraffe, I must say that zebra are comical with their stripes on them. Let's follow him and see if he's got any friends. I'm sure he will have. Now, to carry on the survival topic, could you survive out here in the wilderness? Absolutely. If we were to just do it on our own, for instance, if we were in a plane crash or just got dropped off here with nothing, that was where my previous comment was, and I'd say no. But if I were to choose to come into the bush here with some kit, I would choose to come into the bush with some ready-made shelter, so a tent. I would also choose to come into the area with probably a spade or a machete, which will allow me to access different food sources and access water and access materials that I could build some shelter with. I would come with some medicine, and I would come with some tools to enable me to make fire. The fire, shelter, and water are the three primary concerns that you have out here. And then would come food, and the food would most likely come from insects. Your protein needs come from insects. And what you're busy looking at the moment is some bush with a lot of zebra in. We just see the rump of a zebra there. And there's a couple more there. So what we're going to try and do is actually get a bit closer to those zebra. Now, what will happen is we'll find a distance that the zebra are comfortable having us around at. And what I'm going to try and do is get just that little bit closer so we can see at what distance they'll move away. Generally speaking, if we don't run at them, they will just skirt on the edge of this comfort zone that I'm going to try and establish now. And it's going to be interesting. That comfort zone differs from day to day, in actual fact. So it's going to depend on how we approach these animals. We're not going to approach them directly. We're going to try and go around them slightly and see where this comfort zone is, where the zone that they're relaxed with us is. And let's see if we can spend some time with them. You know, let's see what they're up to this morning. That squirrel is still going crazy. We're definitely going to go and investigate what that squirrel is shouting about. Got about 10 or so zebra. Let's keep on walking just this side. Okay, so there they've moved off. They're in the distance. They're not running away from us. There we go. Literally just stopped where they moved. Let's see now if we take a couple of steps towards them, if they create that distance again. What they're doing is they're also busy track of predator in the area. The shouting of a squirrel has led me on many, many fruitless places. You never quite know what they're screaming about. I think they scream at their own tail from time to time, but they could also scream at leopard, lion, eagles, mongoose, snakes, big lizards. They will shout at all of those. Let's even get a bit closer to these zebra. I'm just getting their movements through grass. Quite tough for you to see because the vegetation is quite thick. I There they're moving off. Still not too alarmed, you'll notice that they're just walking. One might come through the gap. I think let's move up a little bit. And there you go. All those heads watching us. Oh, a lot more than 10 zebra. Wasn't that wonderful? So, what the contributing factor to them moving off like that was the wind changed. All of a sudden, as you can see from the vegetation probably behind my head, wind started gusting, and wind gusted from us to them. So not only were we standing where they could see us, but all of a sudden they got a blast in the face of whatever soap Andrew's been using this morning, and my tick lotion and anti-fly lotion and toothpaste and soap and shampoo and everything else, completely foreign smell here in the bush. And of course it was just a little bit too much for them, so they moved off. Not to worry, they're probably standing at about the same distance away from us as they were when we first saw them, so no harm done. And we're going to carry on walking here looking for these elephants. One of those survival tips is plant. This plant is Arum africanum, or the African weeping wattle, and is a beautifully soft tree.
You can see that I'm in a vehicle today. What a marvelous surprise that was to have Jigger back yesterday evening. Steph has been on foot, as you can see, and Brian and I have just headed out. My name is James, Brian on camera, and we're going to see what we can find here in the way of big and hairies, because of course we've been looking at tiny and not very hairies over the last few days on foot. So my plan is to head down the western side of Juma and see if we can't find some tracks perhaps of wild dogs and that sort of thing. So you're welcome to it. Please talk to us as you've been talking to Steph. Hashtag Safari Live or questions at wilder.tv, and we'll see how long we can keep old Jigger moving. He seems to be okay. Steering seems to be all right. The brakes have functioned once or twice, and all things are looking good. Trying to get an update on the radio. I haven't had much of an update yet. Obviously, there's not a huge amount going on. It's quite a chilly morning, I must say. And I'd say probably about 17 degrees, which is not warm for this time of year. A bit of a front coming through. No more rain since yesterday, though, so that's quite nice as far as game viewing goes. And I think we probably had about 20 millimeters yesterday, which is almost an inch. Pretty good rain, and I think the grass is going to have a nice flush now. During the course of the night, some piece of fluff on my beard. During the course of the night, of course, when you're living out here, the wonderful thing is to hear the call of the hyena, the world's greatest, well, possibly second greatest scavenger, the greatest scavenger being the human being. And Kevin, you want to know the different calls that they make mean different things. Yes, they have different calls for different things. I think we probably are not at a point of understanding exactly what they mean. But they make loud whooping noises when they are marking territory, and when they are contact calling over a big distance, and then they make that laughing, cackling noise when they get close to each other as a form of greeting, and they also do that when they get excited, when they're about to fight with each other, and they make a loud cackling noise. So absolutely, the different sounds they make mean very different things. Tracks on the road, and we always find hyena tracks on the road during the morning. They move mostly at night. There don't seem to be any particular hyena tracks here now, which is unusual. The main tracks that we do see at night time, at least in the morning from the night, are civet tracks, and I've yet to see an actual civet yet here. Civet is like a fat-looking mongoose crossed with a raccoon. Seen one, sort of what it looks like. Very nocturnal they are. And in many parts of the world, the civet is called a civet cat. And country girl Ashley in North Carolina, you want to know, is it true that it isn't a cat? It's absolutely not a cat. And it's part of a family called the Viverridae, and the Viverrids include the genets and the civets. They are not cats. They are more closely related to mongoose, possibly even to hyenas, than they are to cats or to dogs. So although it's called a civet cat in some parts of the world, it is by no means a cat. They've got most obvious difference between them and a cat, of course, is that they've got claws that don't contract fully. They're unable to move their claws in and out of a sheath like the cats. Right, while we get a handle on what's going on in the reserve, Steph is standing on a termite mound, a castle of clay. Let's head to him, and we're going to try and drive a little bit faster and see if we can't find something interesting. See you just now.
One of the eternally fascinating things for me are these termite mounds. These are Macrotermes, the mound-building termites, or fungus-growing termites, and what we're looking in here is the chimney of their mound. Now, what's so interesting is the fact that they were building this last night, and there is so much activity going on in this mound that the heat generated in here is actually keeping the mud wet. Can you believe it? And climbing up inside here is a range of soldier termites, and the reason why they're climbing up here is because, quite simply, I've been blowing into the termite mound, simulating an animal that would come and want to damage the termite mound to get to the termites, and they've reacted to my carbon dioxide by sending soldiers. Now, quite surprising, they've sent the big boys in first, and you'll notice one of them crawling around on the top wall of this chamber. This guy is the heavy artillery, the tank of the termite mound, and is older than 5 years old. Can you believe it? They mature to this size at about 5 years, and it looks like he's going to come out here and come and see if he can bite us. Now, have a look at that. Now, just carrying on the survival theme out here in the bush, this is the easiest and best form of protein that you can get. Now, we need protein to metabolize carbohydrates, and carbohydrates would give us our energy. Protein unlocks that, and also to build muscle and to rebuild muscle that we use. And this is one of those things that we would use to get food from. 100 grams of termite equals a 300 gram steak, which is enough protein for us for a day. So that'll be quite easy to get out here, in actual fact. And Robbie, good morning. Yeah, all the way from New York. Yes, there are absolutely fruits out here and plants. Absolutely, there are plants and fruits that we have out here. The fruits are not that long lived though. You have fruits from about anywhere from now to about the beginning of December, in middle of December, and then plants that are edible are fairly rare out here. You can get medicine from plants, but not a lot to eat. A little bit of carbohydrates from some tubers and some roots, but that's about it. And some sugar from some sugars, some dilute sugars from some of the water plants. But definitely insects is where you're going to be doing it. Insects and carbohydrates and a little bit of fruit and then some plants. You're going to go hungry, that's for sure, living out here. But what's interesting, so interesting for me, is that you can't see it here, but this, the air coming out of this termite mound is warm, hot in actual fact. It's probably in the region of about 30. And you can notice that the lens has fogged up. That's from all the moisture. So you've got a foggy lens at the moment. It hasn't all of a sudden, mist hasn't descended on us. And what I can do is take my sleeve and clean it, although I think Andrew would probably not enjoy that.
I'm hoping it comes right.
Andrew's gonna hope that it comes right. It looks like it's clearing slightly. There, I can start seeing it clearing. Can you believe how much moisture has come out of that termite mound? And there, it looks like all the moisture has left the lens. And Paul has asked, have I seen ants attack a termite colony? Absolutely, Paul. You get an ant out here called the African hissing ant, and they specialize in attacking termite colonies. Not termite colonies like this, they specialize in harvester termites, which don't build these magnificent mounds that we're standing on right now. Have a look at this mound that we're standing on. Don't you find it very odd that it has these pinnacles all over it, rather than a single pinnacle, this one here, or the central chamber, which is the collection point for all this wonderful hot air that's coming out. But we've got all these pinnacles that are all here. And, you know, I'm actually at a loss to explain why this is. Generally, these pinnacles are collection points for hot air, for warm air. And why these termites have made this myriad of pinnacles, I don't actually know. I would imagine that it's because of something to do with their air conditioning system inside here. A very complex system of keeping the optimal humidity and the optimal temperature deep down below here, probably twice as tall as what I am, below where we're standing right now, is a fungus garden. And the fungus are used, are farmed, believe it or not, by these termites. And it's farmed because the fungus has the ability to break down cellulose, which is what makes up the plant cell wall. And then the termites eat the fungus, and that's where they get their energy from. So they're actually just farmers. This is just actually a big air conditioning system. And they are so beneficial to keeping minerals coming to the top of the ground and to keep the soil aerated, that we'd be at a loss without these termites. Now, without further ado, we're going to carry on our walk and find something interesting for you, and you're going to go back to James. We'll see you in a bit.
We are now driving down Impala Road towards Impala Plains. No tracks as yet, but we never know what is going to be around the next corner. And I'm rather hoping to get an update on the Birmingham boys. Now, what is very interesting to me is that we haven't seen them here at Juma for, they came close about 3 days ago. They sounded like they were around Twin Dams area. Then they've disappeared back south into Mala Mala again, which is to the south of us. Lots of elephant tracks on the road here. And apparently there was roaring heard this morning, but who's roaring is quite interesting. I think is quite interesting. Which animals are roaring and what's going on here? There seems to be a bit of a vacuum at the moment. The Mbahumas, who are the pride sort of in charge of this area, are scarce at the moment. They've been in and around, but then they disappear quite quickly again. There's been a real male vacuum as well. So we've got the Salates up in the north. The Matimbas have definitely given up and pushed on. They might come back. They might try and come back. I don't think they will. But maybe those two Salate males, a are going to push further south. Because at the moment, the boundary of the Birmingham Territory seems to be the south of Juma. They have not come this far north for a long time. And the Salates, their boundary seems to be the north of Juma at the moment. They are pushing a little bit further south each time they're seen. Sometimes into, they're normally in Manyeleti, but they have been heading into Buffelshoek, which is the property to the north of us, quite regularly. So, quite interesting to see what will happen. And I think that Juma's kind of a central point at the moment. It's got a bit of a vacuum for, There isn't a settled pattern of lion movement on Juma at the moment. So quite interesting, I think. Now, a very, very relevant query here from Liz as to how old Jigger is. I'm laughing because I was reading something yesterday by Jeremy Clarkson. I don't know if you know who Jeremy Clarkson is, but he, for many, many years, ran a show on BBC called Top Gear. Now, Top Gear was all about cars, and he was, I think he's subsequently been fired for, I think he punched someone, one of his producers, in fact, so a passive, little irascible fellow. He writes a column in the Sunday Times, and I've got a book of his that I just started last night. And the first article in the book is about Land Rovers and how he was comparing German cars with British cars, and how German cars, they don't feel ever, once they achieve perfection, they don't go home and have a bottle of wine and enjoy the fact that they've achieved perfection. They head out again and try and reinvent perfection. Whereas the British, and he used the example of the Land Rover, designed this car, this Defender, at the end of round about the Second World War, and its design has not changed since then. And while it may have been good during the Second World War, by now it is an outdated and antiquated piece of equipment, the likes of which probably shouldn't be seen on the road. This is sort of basically how, where Jigger fits in. Jigger is not a Second World War car. I think she's a 1997 model, but her design is from somewhere around the Dark Ages. I think just after the Great Pyramids of Cheops was built, so the design of the Land Rover Defender 90 was completed. 1997, I think, is how old when Jigger was born. It's quite old for a car that does this kind of work, I must say. I mean, they've got to do pretty hard work out here. So it's not surprising that we do have the odd temperamental issue. They're certainly the best cars for what we do. Otherwise, we'd get something else. And they've got a nice short wheelbase, so it means we can move anywhere compared with lots of the others who have much bigger cars. Yeah, we have some heartbeats. What a deep and abiding joy. Here are some Impalas. While we look at these Impala, ex-Ranger, you make the comment that with working brakes, where is the thrill? Don't worry, ex-Ranger, I don't think the brakes will work for long. These Impala, you might notice, are looking wintry. And by wintry, I mean their fur is standing on edge. And they will do that to trap air further underneath the fur so they can stay a bit warmer. It's a really clever strategy. It's a bit like a bird that fluffs its feathers. And that's because the temperature is chilly and there's a chilly wind. It's unseasonably cold. Brian has got a blankie on his leg, put 4 or 5 jackets on, 2 buffs, 1 hat.
Shoes today.
Shoes today. Good heavens, it must be. Still a lovely morning and you can see possibly the sky there. See a little bit of the horizon where clouds are moving, hopefully clearing away. And of course this time of the year is very good for birds because it's summertime now, and especially after the rain we've just had, there'll be lots of insects around, possibly millions of flies. As soon as the heat comes after that rain, I think we'll have an explosion of insect life, which will be very exciting. But not necessarily of a different bird life. And Liz, you want to know where the secretary birds are? I'm afraid I couldn't tell you. No, Liz, they're not common, A, and B, they're pretty sort of nomadic, so they don't necessarily hang around in an area. So unlike a raptor like the Wahlberg's eagle, which we might find, I mean, those that little pair of pale-form Wahlberg's eagles that live quite close to where we live, pretty predictable movements. You know, if you had to go and find a Wahlberg's eagle, you could be pretty sure you'd find one around there. Same thing. Look, what is that impala carrying, Brian? One at the far front, sorry. It's picking something up and carrying it around. Let me just sneak forward. Sorry, Liz, I'll get back to you. Ram in the front. He was carrying something in his mouth. I think it was probably a bow. That's not uncommon for antelope. I've just never seen it with impala before. They'll pick up bones and suck them, and they don't make their own kills, obviously, but those bones are quite useful for the minerals. Anyway, Liz, so some of the hawk eagles and the battalier and all of those animals. All of those birds are territorial, so it doesn't seem that secretary birds are so much, and they're also much rarer, so it seems that much more difficult. So Liz, if you can find a secretary bird, I will definitely stop it. They are fascinating creatures. They're not very territorial in the same way that, say, the battalier or African hawk eagles or Wahlberg's eagles are. There are some wildebeest. They are walking through the woodland, sort of similar way to the impala are, grazing along, and they will be very happy with the rain that we had yesterday. Be able to eat some fresh grass that will no doubt sprout as soon as we have some decent sun. Grasshopper must be waiting for that kind of rain, and it was very soaking. I dug in the soil yesterday evening just to see how deep it went. Pretty deep down, I think you'll find there'll be a huge flush of green grass in the next few days. Right, let's see what else we can pop along and see. It's wonderful to have a car just kicking almost immediately to life when you start it. A rare pleasure. Back onto the subject of jigger. Carol, you want to know how many miles, well, we don't work in miles here. We left the imperial system along with Queen Victoria. I'm just trying to tell you, I'm just looking at the odometer now to see if it actually changes. So it may have stopped, but what it says is 150,000 kilometers, which puts probably so it's almost 100,000 miles. So quite a lot. And I see that it's not actually working. So the odometer is not working. Now what that means is that it's done a lot more than 151,000 kilometers, which is not a tremendous amount, except that for the kind of work this car's been doing, it is a lot. So call it at least 100,000 miles. I would say it's probably done about 200,000 kilometers, which would sit at about 120,000 miles, and which is quite far, and especially given the kind of hardness with which this car has had to work. So that is quite a long way. Of course, the great raging debate of Toyota and Land Rover is as vociferous and has as many adherents as the argument of Mac versus PC. And the Land Rover it does tend to be something of an emotional buy. It's a beautiful machine. It's not really the most practical in most instances. It's very practical for what we do here, though. It's a perfect car. Toyotas seem to be totally unbreakable, though. And again, if you ever watch that Top Gear program, they do a show on Toyota Hilux. And they do horrible things, do they? Drown it in the sea, they drop it. What do they explode it off the top of a building that they've destroyed? What else do they do, Brian? They drop it from a crane.
Yeah, drop it from a crane.
They can't break it. It's impossible to break. It starts just about every time. So they are totally unbreakable cars. But this car, for what we do, is perfect. Lovely quiet engine when it goes. We're heading towards the lambing season, and those impala that we saw, of course, will be lambing fairly soon, and that means they'll be having their little babies. And their little babies will come in probably the last 2 weeks, or during the course of the last 2 weeks of November. So that will be a very exciting time. And Sharon, you want to know, do they lie down when they are having their babies? No, they don't. They stand up, and that just helps, you know, I think gravity definitely helps the process. Lying down would be a little bit awkward for them. And if I'm not mistaken, human beings, primitive human beings in primitive villages used to give birth, I think, squatting, if I'm not mistaken. I think that was the kind of way that people did it, and possibly very helpful, using a bit of gravity to help. But certainly the animals out here, I can't think of any. I think the predators who have very small babies, you know, blind babies, and lots of them, I think they give birth lying down. But I think you'll find most of the herbivores out here give birth standing up. The fetus is that much bigger, of course. About rare birds, lovely chat about secretary birds, which we will do our best to find. And Siberia Zumi, you want to know if crowned cranes come this far south. We don't get crowned cranes here, Siberia. You might find that there are one or two records for the Kruger, but it would be very, very unusual to see crowned cranes. Beautiful birds they are. Lots in Botswana, of course, and I think more into the Highveld. But they don't tend to come this far south and east. I don't know that there are any common crane species in the Kruger Park at all. I don't think there are. I've certainly never seen any in this particular area. It's quite interesting. The Kruger Park seems to be a melting pot of many different kinds of animals and birds, and that means that there are very few endemic species. And endemic means only found in the Kruger Park. And there are no endemic mammals here. There are no endemic, I don't know that there are any endemic birds. I don't think there are any endemic birds here. So while we're driving along here, what I'll do is I'll just show you a picture of the difference between some of these birds. We had a question coming through about what the difference between a stork and a crane is. They're not similar at all. I suppose superficially they can look the same. So let's just have a listen, see if there isn't anything shouting. And while we're doing that, I'll show you the difference between some of these very tall birds that we've been talking about. So, there be the secretary bird over there. Mm-hmm. That's a secretary bird there. Underneath, obviously, the great ostrich, which might be found once or twice here. You can see them. So there's a secretary bird. So they stand at 125 centimeters off the ground. So that's how many feet is that? That's 3 feet. 3 feet tall. That's pretty tall. More than that, actually. It's about 4 feet. Very tall. Right, so that's a secretary bird. And I'll find this crane. K for crane. 158. There's the grey-crowned crane. And the grey-crowned crane is potentially found maybe in the very south of the park, but very unusual. And you can see its distribution, perhaps, is there into northern Botswana, all around northern Zimbabwe, Mozambique, and then in South Africa, down into Natal, sort of along the east coast there. Not common, though, very uncommon, threatened animal. And then, so the difference between them and a stork, I mean, they're from a totally different family. So superficially, they look the same, I suppose, because they happen to have long legs and they stand about a lot. But the storks, of which we get five or six species in this region, are there. They come from a totally different family. And we'll get all of these, white stork, black storks, Abdom's storks, sometimes a yellow-billed stork, sometimes an open-billed stork. Definitely a woolly-necked stork, so lots of different storks. And they tend to nest, well, they nest around water and they feed mostly in the water, of course. Right, storks, cranes and secretary birds. Sounds like the start of a song, Brian. A song as yet unwritten, so we won't be singing it. Oh dear. Come on, baby. Come on, Jigger. There we go. About lions earlier, and I'm really hoping to see something in the form of a large cat today. It's been a bit of a hiatus of large cat looking at. And a question from a country girl Ash that I wouldn't have thought to ask myself, but I will probably struggle to answer. Why don't all the lions just get together and get along and form a giant mega pride? Country girl Ash, I think it's got largely to do with the fact that too many lions become very difficult to feed. So if you have a pride of 40 lions or so, it's almost impossible to feed them all. So if you get these huge prides of lions, sometimes you do in the east of the park, and we did it in Gala for a stage, we had a pride of about 35 lions. They don't last long together like that. Eventually they split up into much more manageable units. And then they will start to defend territory against each other because they don't want to have, you know, they need to protect their food resources. So that's why they don't get together. But I mean, the same could be asked of leopards. Why don't all leopards get along? And why don't all elephants get along and form mega herds? And the answer is because of the resources. They've evolved into the optimum social groupings of different animals, all the different resources that they're able to use and the kind of scarceness thereof or the abundance thereof. So it does depend very much on their social situation. Right, we're going to head down towards Treehouse Dam, see if anything is going on down there. Nothing much in the way of tracks down at Philemon's cut line. And a cut line out here is a road they often sort of mow on each side of it in order to, so that it forms a fire break. No more fire hazard this year. We've had some good rain, and so the chances of a fire going through here now are almost negligible. Especially not with it being this cold. This is unseasonably chilly. Chilly for us, certainly nothing chilly like you in the Northern Hemisphere probably are feeling at this stage. And again, we've had lots of queries of late, especially as we've been on foot so much, about the safety and that sort of thing. And Sandra in Wisconsin, you want to know what I would do if I was bitten by a poisonous snake. Well, the first thing to say, Sandra, I'll get onto it, is that we use the term venomous for snakes here, not poisonous, because poisonous means, basically, would it be poisonous to eat? So a snake is never actually poisonous. You can eat a snake quite comfortably. So a snake wouldn't poison you, but what it would do is bite you and envenomate you. So they are venomous snakes, they're not poisonous. And if I was bitten by a venomous snake, what would I do? Where is the and where's the closest anti-venom? Well, this is not an easy topic. The closest anti-venom would be in Hoedspruit, which is this settlement just to the sort of northwest of us. It's a very small town, very limited medical facilities, but there is a military hospital there. So if there's an Air Force base. So if something nasty bit me, I could go there. Otherwise, we'd have to go to Nelspruit. Now, you cannot keep anti-venom on site here unless you've got really special conditions in which to do it. And so, basically, the nearest anti-venom to, say, a black mamba bite would be in Nelspruit, which is about a 2.5-hour drive that way, or in Hoedspruit, which is a 1-hour drive that way. And you would need medical attention very quickly. So you'll probably just get in a car and drive, because to get a chopper here generally doesn't, is not a kind of, takes quite a long time to get a chopper here. But the big thing is that anti-venom is not a be-all, it's not like an antidote where you see in the film when someone's been poisoned, they just quickly drink the antidote and then they're okay. Anti-venom can have the same effect on you as the venom if you're not very careful, and if you are not, if you're perhaps allergic to it, you can have shown extreme allergic reaction to it. So that's why we don't try and keep it on site here. Were it to be administered by someone other than a doctor, you could have a terrible reaction in the person and you could actually kill them with the anti-venom. So we don't keep anti-venom here, and that's why. Let's stop here. There's a little bit of sun coming through, which is very pleasant. Here is Treehouse Dam, a great lake of water filled with nothing really, just mud. And there might be the odd catfish left in the puddle. Just trying to see if there's any flopping of tails. Alternatively, they may have all been eaten by the fish eagles, and I know that there's been a marabou stork hanging around here, deeply ugly bird that's been lurking around here eating a lot of the catfish, all the remaining bits and pieces, scavenging on the rotting catfish. But as soon as the water comes, what will happen is that the catfish, either their eggs or the actual adults, which are now lying under the mud in the mucousy film, they will emerge and resume their life. And Lois in Buffalo, you want to know, are there a lot of marabou storks here? Yeah, marabou storks do pretty well out here, you know, and they're very good scavengers, but they're nomadic again, just a bit like those secretary birds. So they'll move around depending on where their food is. They don't tend to be territorial. And that tends to be the case with a lot of scavenging birds. The secretary bird isn't a scavenger, but a lot of scavenging birds will tend to be less territorial than hunting birds. And there's a beautiful mud wallow there. I mean, that is just the perfect, perfect place for a buffalo to go and lie, or a warthog to go and cover himself in delicious mud. I would be sorely tempted, were it a warmer day, to go and lie down in that mud wallow for a little while. Doesn't it look, a perfect consistency? People all over the world in fancy hotels and spas paying hundreds of dollars to be covered in that sort of mud. I'm not convinced of the health benefits myself. I have covered myself in such mud before, and I don't recall feeling particularly rejuvenated by it, but I did have a lot of fun in it. Possibly possibly a gimmick. Now, a little bit earlier, well, not a little bit earlier, on Friday last week, when it was my birthday, I turned 23. Mike, you just reminiscing about that tiny baby elephant that we saw, beautiful little thing, probably a few days old, and you want to know if I've seen it again, and I haven't, Mike. I think they're probably still on Arethusa. I'm sure that herd is lurking around Arethusa. That baby won't move very far because it is so small. So I'm not convinced it's been seen again in this. I don't think it's been seen on Juma, so I haven't seen him again. Hopefully, with not too soon, or not too long before I'll see him. Right, let us now head towards Twin Dams, where the Birmingham boys were last heard calling at Juma. Very pleasant morning now with the sun on our faces. And we were chatting, I was chatting a little bit earlier about possibly a warthog having a wallow in that mud. And then we spoke about the baby elephant. Mike, the Siberia Zumi, you wanted to know how big what a baby elephant weighs when it's born. Siberia, related to the warthog, a baby elephant weighs about 100 kilograms at birth, so that is huge. And an enormous male warthog weighs the same. So does a giraffe calf. So a giraffe calf weighs about the same as an elephant calf. But an elephant calf looks so much smaller. I think they always look so tiny, and they look like they couldn't weigh more than sort of 20 or 30 kilos. But they weigh up to 100 kilograms, which is about 220 pounds. So it's pretty big. Same as a big male warthog or a giraffe calf. Proportionately, a giraffe calf weighs a huge amount more, so a lot more difficult for a poor old giraffe mother to carry that all that weight to term. Beautiful way that the... Oh, there's an alarm-calling squirrel. What are you shouting at, squirrel? I'll just check the road for tracks. Now, squirrels are notorious liars. Something moving through there. An alarm calling all the way down the drainage line. Let's turn on, there's a road just here. Let's turn onto that. I thought I heard something moving there. Hyena tracks here. And just back onto the snake discussion, Country Girl Ash. The mamba is not actually the most venomous snake. It's the snake that can deliver the most venom, and it is very venomous. But the most venomous snake in Africa is something called a tree snake, the wormslung. Very uncommon to be bitten by one of those, and that's because they're very shy and they're back fanged, which means that their fangs are at the back of the mouth, and for them to actually bite you, they've really got to kind of chew on you, and they would really rather not do that. I'm just going to drive slowly along here. There is still some alarm calling activity. So the boomslang or tree snake has got the most, that takes the least venom of any other snake to kill you. But you die very slowly with a wormslung. It's hemotoxic, which means it causes a hemorrhage. There's an elephant in front of us. A It's not what the school's alarm calling at. It's a lovely elephant there, so let's just roll gently down the hill. Looks a little bit irritated that we have come along and disturbed him. He may just have to deal with it, though. Beautiful elephant. This idea, the squirrels are shouting. They're still shouting around here, so we'll just hang about. See if anything pops out. It's a young bull. And I wonder if it isn't the same bull, Brian, that we saw yesterday, one of the two that we saw yesterday at the Juma waterhole. Brian and I had a lovely walk around there yesterday afternoon, and there were two bull elephants there. I wonder if one of them wasn't this chap here. Those squirrels are still going crazy. Just see what he does. You can see he's got that kind of, well, not abrasive attitude, but he's kind of looking at us going, why are you guys here? I find you irritating, is what he's saying, with that sort of swagger that he's got. Let's move a little bit closer. I think he's just being a little bit ornery because he's a bull on his own. Cheeky chops, yes, cheeky chops. Of course, the first thing that you do when you see elephants on the right, Brian, is? That's correct. Now he's just disappearing off towards the drainage line. I think he's a little bit nervous. There he goes. We won't follow him through there, mainly because it's very steep, but also you can see that he's not very happy with us. He'd rather be alone, clearly. Hear another one grazing in there. Now, for an elephant bull to have got to this age is not unusual. Yeah, there's definitely a few more in there. And Sharon, you're quite interested to know what the infant mortality rate is. Now, I think you're hailing us from Johannesburg, which is very nice to hear from my old hometown. Sharon? Infant mortality in elephants would be far, far lower than it would be in many, many other animals, and that's because they have the protection of the herd, and the herd is extremely protective. So where you impala, probably less than 50% will make it to their first birthdays. I think you'll find with elephants it's probably much higher. I think you'll find that 80% will make their first birthdays, and this is a complication at birth or a severe resource depletion of some kind, say a big drought or lack of water or something like that. I think that you'll find most baby elephants will make it to their first birthdays, and then they'll be pretty much fine from there. The herd, like I say, is tremendously protective. So although the predators could easily take a small elephant, for them to get through a herd and take a youngster from the herd is almost impossible. Look into the bush there and see if we can't. Thought I might have seen a leopard lying on a termite mound, but I have seen a stump. That doesn't look vaguely like a leopard when I look at it through my binoculars. Squirrels have stopped alarm calling. Drive a little bit further forward. There seem to be more elephants in front, and we'll see if we can't get a slightly better view of them there. Chilly wind, chilly wind. While we are moving along here, let's link across to Steph, see what he's discovering. He's out on foot, of course, probably off to the east there, I think. So let's head across to him and I'll catch up with you now.
Well, from one animal that needs a lot of water to another that needs a lot of water, and that's us. We need a lot of water out here. Just breathing and just moving around out here, we use about 2 liters of water a day. Now, although that's about 100 times less than the elephants use that you were just watching, nonetheless, finding 2 liters of water in bush like this becomes a bit of a tricky thing. And then when you find it, how do you purify it? Because if you don't purify it, us and our weak constitutions can't really deal with all the nitrates and all the sediment that's in the water from pans and things around here. So you need to purify it. And one of the easiest ways to purify water is, of course, to boil it. To boil it, you need fire, and that we'll cover in a little bit. But you also need a container for your water. Now, I found one of the containers lying underneath this bush over here. I'm going to go quickly stick my face into the bush and get it. So please excuse looking at my bottom for a bit while I rummage around inside here. But here we have the shell of a giant land snail. And it was of the firefly. The firefly larvae or the glowworm larvae feed on these giant, largest land mollusks on the planet. And quite hard. And as you can imagine, when you fill this with water, you can place it on a fire that you've made. Using, obviously, it would be best if you use matches or use a lighter, but you can actually rub some sticks together. Now, in weeks to come, I make a promise to you, a vow, I'm going to make fire on the show by rubbing sticks together, and I'm going to do it from a homemade fire stick or homemade matchsticks, but not today. Today's a little bit too humid to get fire from wood. But there we go. So, receptacle, fire, water, boil for about 10 minutes. It doesn't just help to reach boiling point, it must actually boil for about 10 minutes. And slowly but surely, you'll be able to boil enough water to fill your water bottle or to fill a container. And by container, I mean a tortoise shell or a calabash of some sort out here. That way you can make enough drinking water for yourself. At least 2 liters a day, probably closer to 4 liters would be better. And I'm just having a look to see if anything's living in here. No, and I would reckon, why don't we do a test to see how much water this thing would actually hold? I think that would be good. Andrew, do you think it would be a good idea?
Yes, definitely.
So let's put this down here. I'm going to take off my backpack and all the paraphernalia. I am now unplugged. While I get all this off, which is going to be a bit of a hassle, but let's have a look, see. Surprisingly, that's actually held quite a lot. My bottle was half full, my bottle was there. And I've used, and this is a 750ml bottle, so I would say easily 150ml of water has gone into that. We'll pick it up and empty it out now. Let me get myself plugged in and back in touch with Lou while I do. Now that's actually quite surprising, I must be honest. I wasn't expecting it to hold nearly as much water as that. And, wow, yeah. I mean, and you can have a look over here. You can come and have a look with me. How much water is actually being held inside there. Now, because I know where this wood has been, I can probably, without too much fear, take a sip of this. A little bit gritty. Definitely giving me a bit of a crunch. But no vestigial tastes of the previous owner. I'm not getting any slimy land snail taste in my mouth at the moment, then. Quite good. I've now had three substantial sips and I haven't really even dented it. Would you like some, Andrew?
I think I'll pass, thanks, Stephen.
Without waiting too much. Ah, there we go. And we'll leave the cup here for the next one. Now, you may be asking, can we put something like that onto a fire without it burning? And the answer to that is absolutely yes. You can actually put a paper cup filled with water directly onto a fire. And the reason for that is because water boils at 100 degrees centigrade at sea level. And at a phase change, so from water to steam, the temperature doesn't get hotter than 100 degrees centigrade. And the burning temperature, or the flash point of paper, is higher than 100 degrees centigrade. So you can put a paper cup filled with water onto open flame, and as long as there's water touching the paper, it'll never get hotter than 100 degrees. Now, obviously, be careful if you're going to try that at home, but I do suggest giving it a bash. It works wonderfully well. And if you didn't have access to giant land snails, you could always just use an eggshell. Cut the top of the egg off, empty out the egg, put water in it, put it on the fire, and see for yourself how you can use shells to purify water. And let me know how it goes. On that point, I'm sure James has covered it quite a lot, but you can ask us some questions. You can ask us some questions on Twitter using the hashtag SafariLive, or you can email questions@wildearth.tv and we'll try and answer as many as we can while we're doing that. Shout for the green thorn there. And sorry, go again. We've got, sorry again. Talking about under the Chris, relating to heat from termite mounds. Now, this has no heat coming out of it. But that termite mound had a substantial amount of heat coming out of it. And the question you had was, could we harvest that heat? Chris, you know what? I think that you actually could harvest that heat, to be quite honest. The heat is between 27 degrees and 33 degrees centigrade, winter and summer, day and night. That's how good those termites are. However, the complication, I believe, would come in the fact that to moderate that temperature, the termites are constantly opening up and closing their mounds to moderate humidity and temperature. And I think that they would play havoc with whatever system that you had placed over those termite mounds to collect that heat. But I do think that if you needed to and you had the imagination, I think that you could actually do that. You're working with 33 degrees centigrade, which is probably around about 150 to 160 degrees Fahrenheit. It's quite hot. But this is the burrow of a scorpion, probably the shiny burrowing scorpion. And what's quite interesting is you can actually see where his legs have left indentations there. This is how wide his pincers would have been. He would have been sweeping the mud and debris out of his hole last night after the rains. He would have plugged up the hole with some sand so that he didn't drown. And then after the rains, he would have scooped it out last night, probably. And you can see there's quite a lot of sand out here. I mean, all that come from the inside of his burrow, and it was an existing burrow. Him dry.
I've tried to dig these guys out here, I promise you. Their tunnels extend extensively, at least a meter underneath where we are at the moment. Quite difficult.
Bumpy road. Come to the far east. I don't mean China. I, of course, mean the far east of Juma, Cheetah Cat line. And we're going to head up towards Biffleshook Dam now and see if we don't see anything there. Not a lot in the way of tracks yet. Lots of civet tracks, as I predicted. Otherwise, not a huge amount in the way of tracks. Now we must turn left, otherwise we will be trespassing. Now, on my second or third day here, I was obviously known, in fact, I think it was my second or third week, so I should have known better. I headed straight past these signs, not knowing that this is where the boundary was, and ended up almost in the Kruger Park, and wondered why no one in the final control could hear me, and why I wasn't broadcasting anything in the way of a signal. It was mainly because I was most of the way to Mozambique. It really is pretty chilly out here, and I think Steph is around this area somewhere, so he will be following tracks, I'm sure. And the animals are scarce because they would try and shelter in weather like this. Very little in the way of sun, and when the sun does peep through the clouds, it's extremely pleasant to have it warming one's face. So there are lots of water holes around the place, and I know that the great concerns that people who haven't spent time out here have, flies, is that they're worried about water, and is there enough water, and Bob in Minnesota, you want to know how can it ever rain enough to fill up the ponds or the pans and the dams that we have here. Bob, it probably takes about 100 millimeters of rain, which is in inches. About 5 inches of rain. What's your head here? Brother Brian. There you go. About 500, so yeah. 15, what am I talking about? Totally lost my train of thought. Yes, I've got 150 millimeters or 100 millimeters of rain. About 5 inches or so will probably be enough to fill some of the pans and ponds. But there is a lot of water around here. In the Sabi Sands, 60,000 hectares, or just over almost 200,000 acres. And lots of the different people who have pieces of land in the Sabi Sands pump water. Lots of elephant activity over here, that's why I'm kind of looking around. So there's lots of pumped water, and animals have enough to drink here. There's also a perennial river called the Sand River that runs down through the south of the reserve, and we're not allowed to go there, but of course the animals can go there as they please. So it's not quite as dry as it possibly seems from where you are. We're in a dry season, and we don't get a huge amount of rain here. We probably only get about 450 to 500 millimeters of rain on average, so not a huge amount. We just have tracks of Steph. I've absolutely no idea how to answer this next question about birds, and of course not a lot of birds on a windy day, unfortunately. Kathy in Tennessee, you want to know how many birds we filmed on Live Safari. I don't know that anyone's actually kept a count. Potentially in this area, you'll probably find there's a species list of 280 to 300 birds, but some of those will be vagrants, so just once-off sightings. So you could probably get a regular sightings of birds here, species list of, I'd say, throughout the year, about 250 or so. Now, how many of those we've managed to film on Safari Live, I don't know. I'd say probably not much more than about 100, And that's because, of course, to swing the camera around to catch some of the little things, like the rattling cisticolas and some of the warblers and little tiny babblers and that sort of, not babblers, penduline tits and those sorts of things, and make it very difficult to kind of film them. We could potentially see, I'd say, a consistent list of about 250. And the bird that impresses me the most here, Kathy, it depends the mood, you know. I find the vultures very impressive when we see them. We don't see a lot of them, and we were chatting yesterday, Steph and I, about why it is that there aren't so many vultures around. And it would seem that the traditional medicine trade, where vulture eyes and vulture parts are used extensively, seem to be having a particularly negative effect on the vulture numbers of the area. I'd say the vultures and possibly the... I really love seeing the Wahlberg's eagles when they return from their sojourn overseas and they start to build their nests again. I love seeing the weavers when they start to build their nests again. So I don't think I could single out one bird, Kathy. I have to confess that I have no idea on earth what a weaver fish is. Brian is shaking his head. What is a weaver fish? I'm going to throw that straight back at you. So if somebody can tell me what a weaver fish is, I would love to know. I'm pretty sure we don't get them here. Only a huge number of freshwater fish that we get in an area like this. There are no rivers that run through here. So I'm afraid I don't know. Go to Biffleswick Dam, see if we can find a weaver fish in it. Not too far away from there now. Flies. Steph predicted that the flies would come out in great number today, and they had. He's absolutely right. So we'll turn down this road and then head towards Biffleswick. Lion track. But on closer inspection, it looks like a lot of hyena tracks. And Jeffrey in Austin, you want to know if I have heard of frozen cave lions in Siberia that have been discovered? Jeffrey, I have not. Again, I'd be fascinated to know about frozen cave lions, or any cave lion for that matter. That sounds really interesting. I know nothing about it. Article came up. Have you seen it? Oh, Brian's seen the article this morning. Thank you, Jeffrey. I'll get Brian to forward it to me and I'll have a read. Open the permafrost. Now, lions, of course, used to be found throughout Asia and throughout Europe. And they were made short work of course, not too long into our human history in that particular region. But they did used to be found all over the place, and you'll probably find. Oh, civet. Steph's got a civet on his walk. Let's go across to him quickly.
Alrighty, so We have a civet tree that we right next to over here, myself and Andrew. Andrew actually spotted it, and we've got a variety of different age dungs here. This is a latrine of the African civet called a civet tree. And what's the most interesting thing about the civet tree is the fact that there's such a variety of different things on offer inside them. You can actually get an idea of what is going on in the bush around you. What seeds are in season or what fruits are in season, what insects are around at the moment that they're feeding on. And let's start with the freshest dung. This was deposited last night. And you can see the omnivorous diet of a civet by looking at all the hair and the fur that you can see inside here. And then as we go further down the civet tree, we're starting to get the carapaces of millipedes. That's a millipede carapace. You'll even find, here's another millipede carapace. You'll even find that in the older ones here, if you dig around in them, you'll actually find the teeth of rodents. Quite often in civet trees, I found rodent teeth. Now that's all hair inside there, probably from eating some mice. It's crazy. And they will use these civet trees as marking posts in their territories. And they will have many of these marking posts, in fact. And they will actually hold out until they are in the area to use them. I don't see any teeth in these, just some grass that the civet swallowed for roughage. Very similar to what your dog would have done, or you've seen dogs do. That is a beetle carapace from a click beetle. That is another click beetle carapace. We even... Oh no, that's the fruit covering of some other type of root or seed pod. I actually thought it was some insulation tape. And we're not even close to the lodge. We're probably about 3 or 4 kilometers from the lodge. Feels we're about the same distance away from our cars. Have a look at this massive millipede. Let me resurrect it out there. So you can see the size of the millipedes. Now, what's fascinating about civets eating millipedes, they're actually one of the very, very few, if not the only mammal that can actually eat millipedes. Millipedes are jam-packed full of hydrocyanide, which of course is not only caustic and burns, but it actually is distasteful because of the toxicity of it. Now, as a young man, or young boy actually, I took a millipede. I had a red one in my hand and I had a black one in my hand. I didn't quite know what to do with it. And for some reason, I wanted to swap the two. And I put the red millipede in my mouth to swap hands, and of course, because I'd been handling this millipede, it had started to exude this hydrocyanide across its body. They've got these pores next to their legs that it comes from, and it burnt blisters on the inside of my mouth. My entire mouth was, in actual fact, one huge blister, and it ruined a couple of days of my December or Christmas holiday with my folks. I remember walking around with the biggest fat pumped up lips that you can imagine, not being able to eat or drink anything. And of course, for a young boy inundated with sweets on a holiday, that was catastrophic. Anyway, myself and Andrew are going to carry on. There we go. Andrew's mastering the squat stand, which I'm quite envious of, because I think Andrew's going to be developing legs the size of a power lifter by the time we finished with these walks one day. Now, an interesting plant that's coming up over here. Sticking to our survival theme, this is the leaf of the cedar cordifolia. And I'm going to see if you can get that very, very fine hair that you can see. The leaf is actually hypoallergenic and is covered in the most beautifully soft, velvety furs. And as you can imagine,
Having access to something, they will get a bit bigger, they'll get a bit bigger like this. Having access to a plant that is hypoallergenic and have beautiful velvety soft leaves will make comfort stops in the bush a lot more pleasant, if you can catch my drift on where I'm going with this. So one of those things that we walk around with and collect and put into your pocket for those comfort stops that rush upon you from time to time, especially if you're drinking water unpurified out of snail shells. But quite interestingly, the ladies around the area, the Shangaan women around the area, will also collect these when they're foraging in the bush and use them as babies' wet wipes. They're very effective as baby wet wipes, and because they have no spikes or poison of any sorts, they don't cause any irritation. Anyway, let's carry on. Here we have a millipede, talking about millipedes. So what this millipede has done is roll up in a defensive strategy, and from the base of its legs there, it will now be exuding this hydrocyanide. And Barbara wanted to know, do meerkats also eat millipedes? And Barbara, absolutely. The civet isn't the only animal in Africa that can digest millipedes, or the mammal, not only animal, only mammal, but they are very few and far between. Millipedes are difficult to digest to this hydrocyanide. They have a hard outer covering and their legs. And what I want to show you is there's a mite inside there, a millipede mite. What you may be able to see is a tiny circle on the inside of that millipede. Mite is having a bit of a signal problem. Every time Andrew seems to get close to me, the signal drops. So we'll ask Andrew to stand a little bit further away, and hopefully you'll be able to see that little mite that's inside there. You'll see it's just there. Now the millipede has tucked its head away, but I'm going to be placing the millipede right back to where I found him. The reason why I picked him up was to get him out of the path of Andrew. Andrew is obviously walking, concentrating on the picture that he sees through the camera lens and not really on his feet, and I was worried that he'd step on this millipede, which is why I brought his attention to it and why we picked it up and moved it out of the way. Now we're going to carry on, and let's carry on going. Good morning, Molly, all the way from Ohio. And you've asked if we have any aloe plants out here with aloe vera in them. And yes, there are some that have aloe vera in them here. And aloe vera is a fantastic one lubricant, so for a little bit of chafe when you're walking around in the bush, for sunburn. And I use aloe vera, or the aloe here, for sunburn. I use it on my face, especially this gargantuan nose that I seem to have been blessed with, along with my Mickey Mouse ears, which stick out at a variety of angles from my body and seem to attract the sun quite intensely. I'll use aloe vera on sun damaged areas, and it soothes and cools and helps repair the skin. And yes, you do have some aloes here, not where we are at the moment. They seem to be restricted to some rocky areas here. Now, it's not that we can't walk to a rocky area. We can actually walk to most places out here within a fairly short space of time. And what you do is, if you were stuck out here, is you'd get to know your area. It's dangerous to just keep on moving from one place to another. And what you need to start doing is to build yourself up a base and then operate from that base. And
When you've set up a base, you can then know where the water is, you'll know where some good foraging areas are, where you've put up some snares and some traps, and you'll also get to know where you can access your bush medicine from. And aloe vera would be one of those places, or the aloe plants would be one of those places where you'd then go and harvest if you needed to, you know. But James is sitting with some hippo at Buffalzook Dam, and while myself and Andrew crash through here, you're going to go and enjoy them. We'll see you in a bit.
So we have come to Buffalzook Dam, and there we find some hippopotamuses. And you can see quite clearly that while they are standing on the ground there, they're almost in the deepest part of the dam, and the water is running out. And I mean, we had some questions earlier about the rain and how dry it is and how on earth can it ever get wet enough and how do these dams fill up? Well, they do, and it takes less rain than you think it does. Probably more of a storm than the soaking stuff that we had yesterday, because some of the drainage lines will need to flow before there can be rain. But those hippos there are, well, I'm fascinated as to where they've come from, because certainly for a long time there were no hippos here at all. And what I suspect has happened is that as the other water holes have dried out, so the competition for space has become that much greater, and so animals have, like the hippo, have chosen to come to what might be termed as a marginal waterhole areas. So this doesn't seem to be a particularly popular hippo hollow. I don't think it's not very big, and you can see around here that all the grazing is pretty much denuded, and that will happen next to waterholes. The grazing will get taken out pretty quickly. And so this is not sort of optimal habitat for hippo, and they may have even come from the Sand River, where obviously it's now starting to dry out probably quite badly, and the competition for space will be huge. That the river though, the Sand River, the major rivers will start to flow quite nicely now after that rain that we had yesterday, because they rise a lot further to the east, and it's amazing how the further east you get in this area, the greater the rain. It really does make a substantial difference. Even sort of 20 kilometers further east of where we are, they'll get a lot more rain than we do, especially early on in the season. Let's have a listen to what we can hear. There's quite a lot of going on around here. You can hear the odd wagtail, the choop choop choop. A couple of drongos. And hear the rustling of the wind. A few ring-necked doves. And Joanne and Sandra, thank you very much for the information you sent through about the weaver fish, which doesn't occur here, mainly in the Mediterranean apparently. And the weaver fish is very poisonous if you stand on it. We definitely don't have that in this area. So Country Girl Ash, there's your weaver fish answer. We don't get them here. And we do get the odd kind of poisonous fish, or not necessarily a fish, but sea-dwelling creature around our coastline. So something called the sea urchin, which I think you get all over the world, which can cause you quite nasty infection if you get the spines stuck in your foot and you don't clean them out properly. But otherwise, not a huge number of poisonous things to stand on, especially around the water. Your biggest danger around water, of course, is crocodiles, and that's what you want to watch out for. So even in a water body like this, if I had been here 100 times, which I have probably, and I've never seen a crocodile here, I would still never go into a water body like this. It's too dull, you can't see what's going on, and the crocodiles do come in and out of these areas with amazing regularity. Right, we're going to move on from here. Let's nip across to Steph. He's got something tiny but fascinating to show you, and we'll see you just now.
Oh, differ from a rolled up millipede to one that's been walking around over here. We found one on a branch busy foraging what looks to be like some lichen. And I just love the way that these millipedes walk. Have a look at their legs. Millipedi means thousand leg. And in Afrikaans, they call this the Dasenpoot, the thousand legged millipede. And have a look at that motion that they've got going through there now. One of the more common of the insects over here, I must be honest with you. And as you will see, as the season progresses, they become super, super abundant. This one's actually been injured right there. That segment looks either fused in some scar tissue or misaligned in some way. Now, what's amazing is that every segment, every one of these segments, has two legs that come out of it, as opposed to the centipede, which only has one leg coming out of it. And they are detritivores, so they eat vegetation, detritus, and that's what he's looking for. And the reason why he's so slow is because it's still quite cold this morning. They gain metabolic energy from the temperature of their environment, and that's why he's not moving fast. Now, you'll notice from his feelers or his antennae in the front, that's how he's busy sensing his environment at the moment. And it's actually fascinating watching how those antennae are touching the world around him. We're going to try and see if he understands what my stick is. And there, absolutely. Have a look at this if you can. See if we can make a difference. He's busy eating over his stick. So it's got some of my scent on it, and have a look at how that feeler will, you see, back away. Close in our excitement over there, and the signal was dropping a bit, but didn't you find that insane how he absolutely, wherever I rubbed on that stick, he was able to, or she, it, it's actually a hermaphrodite, they are both sexes, was able to taste or sense that I'd been touching that stick. I mean, I find it incredible to think that we coexist on this planet, and yet this animal has absolutely no concept of what a human is and the massive impact that we have on their environment. Equally so, you know, I'm actually at a loss of more information to tell you about these millipedes. We know so little about their biology and about their life cycle. I mean, it's explained in books and textbooks, and you could probably go sit endlessly on lectures about millipedes. They're not an uncommon insect by no means. But how they interact with the environment, I mean, and from interacting on this level, and we're now going to interact on a slightly different level. You're going back to James and the vehicle. I think he's left Bivel's Hook Dam, and we're going to carry on. We'll catch up in a bit.
So to Impala, we've moved away from Bivel's Hook Dam because they are, nothing much was going on. The hippo were lying there and very little else happened. We did see two stork species there, but they flew off, woolly-necked and saddle-billed. Now we have two Impala here. And you can see the far one seems to be a bit nervous of the closer one. And we had a fascinating discussion yesterday with Steph, because he, 2 days ago, saw two Impala going hell for leather at each other, which would seemingly be completely the wrong time of the year. And Steph explained it by saying that the estrogen levels on many of the ewes are rising as they approach the lambing season. And that is creating this kind of conflict between the rams, because it's giving them a kind of physiological response that says that the females are coming into estrus, which of course they're not. They'll only come into estrus in May next year. I'm not going to move, because starting the engine is definitely going to affect him, so we'll just let him walk straight in front of us and appreciate him. Now, nothing in the way of big game going on here at the moment, but Such a stunning animal is the impala, amazingly athletic. And they're so common. We had lots of questions about water lately. Here comes another one behind him. There we go. There's lots of discussion about water of late. And impala, of course, are completely water dependent. Now that means that if there is no water, impala do not survive. But when there is water, they totally outcompete everything else. And so that's why you find so many impala in the Kruger National Park for many, many years. And I mean, we're still living with the effects of it here in the Sabi Sands. People pumped water, dug dams, and dammed up drainage lines, and they've put bits and pieces of artificial water all over the place. And that's been tremendously advantageous for things like impala and zebra, and really disadvantageous for beautiful animals like the sable or the roan antelope, what they call the hippo tragi, or the horse-like antelope. And then, of course, for things like eland and hartebeest and sesebi even. And they're going into Biffle's Hook there, possibly towards some water that's a little bit less grey and greasy than the Biffle's Hook Dam. Now, the weather is not great. In fact, it's pretty foul, to be honest. Blustery. I always find that if it's going to be grey, then it should be raining, really. I feel it's unfair otherwise. Edward, you want to know if some of the animals seek shelter during storms or during the rain? Some animals do, Edward. It becomes a total waste of time after a while, though. So, I mean, if it rains enough, if it rains lightly, you can go and find a nice tree to stand underneath. It maybe a mahogany tree. Not many of those here, but you know, if you're an elephant or a lion, you might go and find a tree like that to stand underneath. But eventually, of course, if it's a proper storm, no tree is going to shelter you properly from the rain, and then animals give up. And that's exactly what happened. So they'll go into kind of thick bush when it starts to get a bit drizzly and cold, and eventually, if the rain continues, they get hungry and they just accept the fact that they're wet, and they get on with it and come out and they eat and do get on with their lives as they would normally. A bit like us, really. Or a bit like kids. You know how kids are. Kids will rush in during the rain, and if the rain continues and they really want to go outside and play and it's not too cold, they'll just deal with the rain. Out they'll go and just cope with it. It's a bit the same with the animals out here. So we're now on the Biffle's Hook cut line, just checking if anything's come across during the night. There's been no game drive activity in this area this morning. Taxon and Aubrey from Juma are not out at the moment. So we are flying solo on Juma with Steph, of course, and he is just, he's not too far from Biffle's Hook there. You saw that millipede. I believe an epic millipede sighting. So you might lose us as we go through this dip. Obviously, sometimes the signal here isn't great, but we'll pick you up on the other side of the dip. Brian and I had a wonderful dung beetle sighting just through there about 4 days ago, 3 days ago. We had a pile of very fresh elephant dung. There was a glorious maroon-coloured dung beetle there, covered with kind of golden, well, it was golden elephant dung, really, and I think just a beautiful arrangement of colours in the morning light. Very few dung beetles yet, because we haven't had huge rain, but I think you'll find that the dung beetles, when as soon as it warms up now after this last batch of rain, start to come out in their hundreds. one of the birds that I've been most desirous to see, in other words, one I wanted to see the most, has been the weavers that come back and they turn beautiful yellow colours during the summer times. And the weavers that we get here that I'm talking about, there are lots of different kinds. Southern masked and village weavers and lesser masked and even the red-headed weavers. And Virginia and Kentucky, you want to know, do they always build in communities or colonies? They do, actually, most of them. The red-headed weaver have very kind of sparse communities or colonies, but absolutely they build in colonies where... So, I mean, we've got one species, the red-billed buffalo weaver, which actually makes a community nest. So it's one nest with lots of different couples in it, whereas most of the rest of the weavers will weave nests in colonies, so they're not necessarily communal breeders. Lots of individual nests just in the same area, and I'm very amazed by the complete absence of weaver activity yet. We're almost in November, and to not have seen one weaver yet this season, I think is astonishing. Lots of nests from last year. I don't know where they are. Maybe the drought last year affected their numbers quite badly. Maybe that's why they haven't been back yet. But this is really late for them to have not even started building around here. Nothing in the way of tracks, I'm afraid. Quite a few hyenas that have been around during the night, but no big cats that I can see. Heading towards the Sydney's Dam, which is an enormous dam just inside Biffles Hook, and there are normally some hippo there. And Tina, you want to know how it is that hippos move waterhole to waterhole, and when do they do that? Tina, they move up to 50 kilometres in a night, they can. So it's really not difficult for them to get from waterhole to waterhole, and especially in an area like this when there is quite a lot of water. They will move during the night, but we've seen them walking during the day. In fact, Brian and I saw one, it was with you, Brian, wasn't it? At an injured hippo that came up the drainage line late in the morning. It was quite hot, and he was very clearly quite badly injured by something, and he came through the Juma Dam, and which has no water in it at all. They move around very happily during the day. They are limited by sun though, so they need to stay out in the very bright sun. Aye. Okay, cool. A couple of staff who work for a camp in Took called Cruise Camp, and I just asked them, were there any animals around? And they said they haven't seen anything, unfortunately. They're just coming from the gate. So, Tina, just to quickly finish the hippo discussion. Hippo are limited by sun. They do get sunburnt, so they will try and avoid moving in open sun or in the lions. Unfortunately, heading straight towards Biffles Hook. Don't go anywhere, chaps. Look at that. Isn't that nice? This looks like...
Jingala.
No, this is Salala Pride. Three young males, three young females. Oh, where have you been all morning and now you're going to cross north? Oh, very sad. Anyway, beautiful to see them. We're going to have a brief view of them. Stations, looks like Salala Pride crossing north into Biffles Hook, just to the eastern side of Tambuti Dam on the next ridge crest. Yeah, affirmative, the Salala Pride. Looks like three young males, one female. Alright, let's just quickly reverse back so we can get a slightly better view as they disappear. Oh. Very sad that they're going to be leaving us. How wonderful to see them. Such a huge rush when you suddenly see them coming out of the bush and they're unexpected. guys. Don't you want to just turn a little bit to the eastern side and leave us just here? So we've got the three young males here and only one female. I don't know where the other females are. I wonder if they haven't headed into Bufusuk already.
Injured boy.
He is injured. He's the one with the... You can see he's graunched out a little problem in his bottom. But it seems to be getting better. What are they running at? I think they've heard something. Let's just quickly turn around. Let's see. I wonder if the other two lionesses aren't further north than Biffle's Hook. They're all running now. We did look behind them briefly. Just the four of them, the other two lionesses, like I say, are not here. If any station is interested in these, in this pride, they are now at Tambuti Dam. I will have to leave them, so I can't follow them from here. Beautiful. Now, for them to be moving at this time of the day is indicative of the temperature and perhaps that they've been disturbed by something. And by disturbed doesn't necessarily mean a negative thing. Perhaps the other two lionesses have caught something or they're on the hunt here. But where they are is very interesting to me. I wonder why those four seem to be on their own. Yes, I share the sentiments of Eddie Abbey, who says, time to bring out the catnip. Absolutely, time to track them back towards Juma. So, just in case you happen to be a new viewer, this road here is a border between two properties, and we are not allowed to cross it. The animals, of course, can cross it at will, but we can't go across because of human property laws. There you go, Brian. Is that right? The back. We're standing on the little dam wall there. Okay. And they're listening. They're listening very carefully. And smelling. And I'll keep looking behind us just to see if the other two don't appear from somewhere. But they're definitely listening very carefully. Smell will be difficult for them now because there's a fairly strong breeze coming from the southeast. And as Coutinho John points out, it is possible to attract lions by making the distress call of a buffalo being killed. How ethical that is questionable. I've certainly seen it done. It is amazing. You make a proper distress call of a buffalo being killed and the lions react immediately. They come rushing across. So, sorry, I think I got myself a little tongue-tied when I was talking about the injury on that one male. They're now having a little lie down there. So that young male there has an injury on his backside that seems to be healing. I think he was bitten by a hyena there. It could have been an injury from a hunt. And Christina in Texas... How can this be a pride, you say, because it's only got one female? Christina, it's actually a pride that's normally with three females. Now, you do point out an interesting kind of dynamic. The pride, of course, is the females and their youngsters. So even if it was only one female here and these were perhaps three males that she'd given birth to, it would still constitute a pride. These males are not dominant in the area at all. And so they could potentially all be brothers. In fact, they look like they're brothers to me. So I suspect they are the offspring of one of the females. So even if that was their mother and these were the three sons, it would still constitute a pride. Now, once they move off to become dominant lions in a coalition of their own and they go and try and take over an area, well, then they cease to be part of the pride. And then the female, if she remained on her own, well, she'd be a single lioness, but I suppose, she wouldn't be described as a pride then. So, Christina, I hope that answers your question. Pride is essentially made up of related females and their offspring. I'm very, very lucky and fortunate to find these beautiful lions. And they don't normally move around, like I say, this time of the day. I think it's got to do with the weather and the fact that something's going on there in Buffelshoek. I wonder if the other two females aren't perhaps below the dam wall there, although they would have greeted them. So maybe not. Maybe they heard them calling and they're heading that way and trying to hear them again. Lions will make soft contact calls. Right, well, we'll stay with these lions for a little bit longer, and probably the rest of the morning, because I don't know how much time they're going to spend on that dam wall. Let's nip across to Steph. He's got something much skinnier to show you, and we'll stay here and see you with them just now.
I'm sorry to have stolen you away from those lions, but I've got something that I just have to show you, and I'm not actually sorry at all. There's a massive predator. You've just had a predator, and now you come to a predator, another one of a different ilk. This is a praying mantis, one of the assassins of the natural kingdom, and I'm going to be pointing him out to you, an unbelievably camouflaged insect, and you can have a look there. He's over there. Four legs that he uses for locomotion, and the front two legs, which are those two there, he uses to catch insects in claspers with some spines on them. And you can actually see the way his head swivels to watch my finger. Very good eyesight. Now, how we found him is this: he was running from one woodpile to another. And you can actually see that this praying mantis is geared specifically to hunt in these wood piles. You can see that he looks almost identical to the piece of grass that he's next to and to the sticks that he's hunting on. And he will be hunting for insects that live in these wood piles. At the moment, he's using his stealth and his camouflage to stay hidden and using his eyesight to pick up movement of insects, which he will then stalk and catch by extending these arms and catching them in the claspers that are located right there. Isn't that just absolutely fantastic? Have a look at the colors all over that body. Now, they come in many different colors. You get them even in pinks and yellows. Those are obviously praying mantises that hunt on substrates that have those colors. This particular praying mantis hunts on these wood piles. Bizarre body structures like flowers in with their camouflage.
Lions have not moved. I hope you enjoyed that little stick insect with Steph. Steph, of course, is not a stick insect. Now, nothing further has developed since you left us. I think one male is below the dam wall there, and then the female and two males top. And they're still listening. They're kind of looking into the north, seeing if they can hear anything. Squirrel alarm calling in the distance. He's clearly seen them as well. Now, this is quite a nice, while we're sitting here looking at them sort of in the distance, it's quite a nice way to understand how a male coalition of lions develops.
And country girl Ash, you asked the question, will these males stay together? Yes, they will most likely stay together. And in a year or so, when they are chased out by the dominant males of the area, they will form a coalition that will eventually, probably a year or so after that, take a territory of their own. Could be close by, could be miles and miles and miles away. It will just depend on what's vacant at the time that they get to the size that they're able to take over a territory. So this is how a coalition starts normally. In a pride, you've got three brothers or cousins of similar age. They know each other well, they're bonded well over the years, and they will eventually go off together. Now, sometimes what happens is like a single male like Junior, who used to belong to the Nkuhuma pride, and we can now probably safely say he's no longer in the pride, he on his own is going to really struggle to take a territory, because as we've seen, we've got the Birmingham boys, there are five of them. There were originally five Matimba males, there were five Mapohos, in fact there were six to start with. There were five Majingalan males, there's nine Skybed males. So enormous coalitions of lions in this particular area, and while many of them will split down to kind of numbers of two or three, very seldom does a lion in this area manage to take a territory. Something's squealing. Something's been killed. Either that or it's a monkey shouting. It's difficult to hear with the wind. It's going to sneak forward. It is in buffalo circle. You saw the lion look up there. One of the lions is up and he's looking. Let's just have a quick look at what they're going to do. What on earth that sound? Sounds like something being killed, but possibly a squirrel. Yeah, it's still going. Most bizarre sound. Might be a bird being killed by another bird.
That sounds bird-like.
You hear that, everyone? I'll try and sneak a little bit more forward and see if we can't pick up what it is. Look, two drongos flying off. Starling going off. I think that was two birds having a fight with each other. I remember a little while back we had two drongos fighting, and they did make quite a similar sound, I think, while they were lying on the ground fighting with each other. So perhaps that's what it was. Whatever it has ceased. Definitely bird-like. Let's go back to the lions. If it had been something mammal-like, those lions would have got up and they would have come running over here to see. Right, we'll roll gently back down the hill. And I'll answer Eddie Abbey's question about whether that lioness is an adult. She looks like an adult to me, yeah. She's a little bit bigger than these males. She might not be an old adult, because I know that some of them in the Salada Pride have got those little pink noses, so they're not. They're definitely younger than six. I don't know if this is one of them. But yeah, she's an adult. Let's roll gently back and hope that they're still sitting there on the wall. Yes, they are. This view's going to be here. It's going to be important. So where's the line? What's the line? Okay, now, so we were just discussing the male lions and their coalitions and how and what they form. And in the Sabi Sands, in the late 70s, I think it was the late, no, it was probably the early 80s, middle 80s, there was a big black maned lion who became known as Big Black. And Big Black lived down at Londolozi. And he Big Black was a lion who lived on his own. Big Black lived on his own. He's the only lion of the Sabi sands that I know of that managed to hold a territory completely on his own for a long time. I think he actually held it for 2 or 3 years, totally on his own. Apparently he was truly enormous. An enormous male lion with a very black mane, and apparently you did not want to spend time with him on foot. If he saw, sometimes he'd charge vehicles, sometimes he'd charge, well, he'd always charge people on foot if they came anywhere near him, and he was something of a terrifying lion. And I think the only reason he managed to stay where he did and managed to hold the territory for as long as he did was because he was big, A, and B, clearly was born of a huge amount of testosterone, and so he was particularly aggressive and particularly unwilling to bow to any kind of pressure. So I think he would have kind of fought to the death, really, rather than back down. And sometimes if you're big enough, you can take that approach. And if animals, other animals are slightly less risk-taking, they'll leave you alone. But other than that, you know, Junior, I don't think is going to have kind of anomalous situation. I don't think Junior is going to have the same kind of luck. So he's going to have to find another single male lion and form a coalition. And that's not unusual. They're definitely fascinated by something going on to the north and east of them. They're going into the little teenager phase, these young males. And they've had quite a nice meal. I can see, I'm just looking with my binoculars at their bellies. Seem to have had something to eat last night, maybe something small. Dove calling behind us, but there's also a squirrel sitting in a tree the opposite side of the dam. He's obviously looking at those lions and he's going cheer ticket, cheer ticket, cheer ticket, cheer ticket, cheer ticket, alarming at them, warning other creatures that there could be danger lurking. Well, clearly it is lurking in plain sight. As you can see now, the exertions of staying awake for more than 2 hours of the day are starting to take their toll on these lions, and they're starting to nod off. It is amazing how they sit down and almost immediately their eyes start to close. But that's not to say they're not aware. Something moves around in the bush, they smell something. It is astonishing how fast they can stand up and move. And just to clarify something, and it comes sort of from a statement that Barbara's just made, that the blacker the mane, the more virile the male. Yeah, this is virile necessarily, Barbara, but certainly the blacker the mane, apparently the more the testosterone a lion has. And that, of course, means, and the more testosterone has, the more dominant he will be able to be, because the more willing he will be to fight and the more kind of aggressive he can be. And out here in lion society, your size and your willingness to fight are the definers of how dominant you can become. Well, I don't think we're going to spend too much longer with these fellows. They don't seem to be doing a great deal. I just want to go and pop down, see if we can't find the other two or see evidence of the other two lionesses. I just wonder where they've gone. Right. Marvellous to have seen the lions, finally. And a great surprise, because we weren't tracking them. So just great to have them walk into view. I find it so exciting when that happens, and that's why it's just so great to work out here, because you really don't know what's going to be around the corner. Okay, great stuff. Let's press on. Let's see what else we can find. I suspect that they will lie around there for much of the rest of the day. With any luck, they'll come back down, perhaps towards the Juma waterhole. Lions do sometimes come in the middle of the day down there. I don't know why. It seems to be an attractive place. Possibly because there's fresh water there, it does attract animals when they come down and see if there isn't a snack in the offing. I'm just going to tell the rest on the radio that I've left them. Station's leaving this pride. It's only three young males and one female standing on top of that wall. Right, so they came out of the bush just over there, and there's a road not too far from here. So we're going to go down that road and see what we can see. Maybe some hyena activity. They've attracted them in here. Maybe those other two lionesses, who knows? Now again, there is a huge vacuum in lion dynamics, which I'll get on into. But let's just nip across to Steph. I think he's got something else fascinating to show you. And I will get into the lion dynamics as soon as we see you next.
You know, we never really show you these animals, and fair enough, as field guides here, we hardly ever see these animals. We see the excavations often, but we don't really see them. It took me about 12 years of guiding before I saw my first aardvark or ant bear, and I've been looking at excavations like this since one of the very first days that I started guiding. This is the excavations from an ant bear last night. What's quite interesting is that you can see, you can almost in your mind picture this animal. Now, an ant bear looks very similar to a pig. Same color, same texture of hair on its body. A little hunchback animal with a long tubular nose that houses a tongue to catch termites. And this animal would have come and put its two back feet here, where my hands are, two back feet, its tail would have lain here. You can actually see the indentation here of where its genitalia was pressed into the sand. So two back feet here, tail down on the ground like this, and it dug into the termite mound, putting its one foot here and the other one into the termite mound. Digging with one foot, digging the termites out, sitting pretty similar to how I'm sitting at the moment. Would have snuffled around in there for some termites. In actual fact, as I've been digging around over here, the ants have actually come out. So it wasn't termites, it was ants. Yeah, the ants here. Snuffled around, licked up some ants. This actually went from here. He put his foot here, and he put his foot there. Here's the three toes of that ant bear. There, he stepped up, put his other leg there, and then there, and he walked off. So that's this ant bear's track. So in your mind, what you can do is picture me. I have a long tail resting down here. I have my two back feet pushed here. I'm putting my one paw here. I got the indentations. I'm scraping, snuffling around inside there. Then I put my leg up there. Sorry, this I put. I move this one to here, this one here, I push up, and I carry on walking with my day. And that's how this ant bear dug this picture. And that's what I'm picturing in my mind when I've got this animal that I've so loved to show you. It would be so fantastic to show you, but unfortunately they only come out at about 11 o'clock at night. And right now, although that's not the plan for always, but right now we don't do night safaris, so can't show you them, unfortunately. But nevertheless, let's carry on going and let's see what else we can show you. Is Andrew falling down the Tamarama? Yeah, right there, bud.
All good, all good.
Trying his best to impersonate a landslide, not an aardvark. Are you okay?
Yeah.
I must say, you got that camera kept quite steady there, Andrew. You wouldn't have spilt your drink there. 10 out of 10. Now, we're wandering through this thicket looking for interesting things to show you. And I must say, it's been a never-ending source of wonder. It started off, the thicket started with that little praying mantis that we showed you just now, and that beautiful sequence of tracks with that ant bear or aardvark. I actually love picturing in my mind what those animals were doing. And you can quite easily do it at home with your pets, your cat or your dog. Watch how your cat walks across the lawn. Watch the tracks that they leave in the snow or in the sand or in the dew on the grass. And then in your mind, when that cat is gone, picture what your cat looked like looking at the footprints on the ground. And you'll get an idea of what I'm trying to do in my head. And what I do when we see tracks of lion on the ground or where we see tracks of leopard in the bush, you have to be putting yourself in that animal's mind so that you can track. Because to track footprint for footprint, Acha, would be a very difficult, impossible thing to do, actually. You've got to start thinking like these animals to find them. Now, we stopped talking a little bit earlier. We had a little bit of a signal breakup when we stopped talking about finding scorpions as a protein source. So we had a little bit of protein with the termites, the best and easiest form of protein. But in actual fact, scorpions are another easy way of getting the protein that you need if you were to survive out here. Now, I was with some bushmen. I was lucky enough to spend some time with some bushmen in Botswana for a couple of weeks, and they ate a scorpion almost every day. But there are a lot more scorpions there, actually. It seems like there's a lot more. There actually are probably a few more here, in actual fact. But how they caught it was quite interesting. They took a piece of grass similar to this. They each carry a spear, and at the back of their spears is a flat piece of wood which they use as a digging stick. And I won't do it, but I'm just going to show you the theory. They put it into the scorpion hole, then they dig around the base, then they put the grass a bit further, dig around the base, further, dig around the base until they uncover the scorpion. They dug on average probably about a meter, which is about 3 yards deep, that deep. And uncovered a scorpion almost every single time, at which point they'd just lop off the tail. They'd either fry it up on a fire right there by just throwing it onto a fire that they quickly make, or they eat it raw. They just crunch it in raw. So yeah, these bushmen, they knew how to do it. Obviously a lot smaller than what we are. Us as Europeans or Americans, Caucasians tend to be quite big bodied. I probably weigh about 25 or 30% more than what those bushmen weighed. So I obviously need more food to keep me going. I get hotter quicker. It's just one of those things that happen. They supremely adapted to living in the environment that they do, and did quite well on a diet of scorpion and termite, actually. Carry on wandering through. I love these dead trees that we find out here. Always this one isn't dead, this is a marula tree. But it has some of its bark has come off, which of course has exposed the hardwood to insects, fungus, and animals. And you can the shot hole borers, this is the larvae of the beetles that eat wood. So the beetle is the adult, the larval form is a grub or a larvae that live inside wood, and they can live inside wood for decades. Of these shot hole borers, at about 10 to 20 years of them living inside this wood. Wood is obviously quite poor in nutrition, and so they need to spend a long time building up these massive fat bodies to digest enough energy to metamorphosize from a grub into a beetle that can fly, obviously, and doesn't live in wood, which is another one of those nature's most fascinating things, is how metamorphosis works and how animals change from egg to worm, living in wood and able to crunch through this, to flying around with hard carapaces and flimsy antennae looking for detritus, flowers and pollen. Just the way it changes is just incredible. And another quite, this doesn't have any flowers on it, but this gets a little blue flower. This is a commelina, and this is used as a thickening agent for porridge. So what I'm going to do is squash it up a little bit, and you'll see that there'll be a pulpy juice that comes out, and eventually what's going to happen is you'll see that it'll get quite slimy. And that you see there, that slimy sap, is used as a thickening agent for some of the porridges, almost like, I suppose, a mazina would be, or something like that. You can see the shiny fingers. I'm actually going to taste it. I want to taste what it tastes like. Tastes like nothing, which is good. One of the things to do is you rub it on your tongue or your lips and see if you can taste any burning, anything acidic. I taste nothing of the sort. The hairs are not irritant, so all good. So, commelina gets a nice blue flower, thickening agent for porridge and for stews out here, and used quite extensively. Carol has wanted to know if we have rosemary growing in the bush. Firstly, hello Carol, and we do have a type of rosemary, but it's not like the rosemary that we'd get in the gardens, Carol. It's a herby rosemary, almost like a mixed herbs rather than that. And when I find some, I'll definitely show it for you. But now I've found another one of these. This one has obviously been stepped on by something that was feeding underneath the tree and has been crushed, so we can't use it as a cup. But don't you find, have a look at those pictures inside there, those patterns from the shell. Now a snail has, yeah, it does. Anna Maria's mentioned that this looks like a conch shell that you find in the sea. Absolutely, it's nice and smooth. It's quite flinty. It's hard. I mean, I'm trying to break that edge there to show you, and I can't. I mean, that's as much strength as I can put into that. Oh, there we go, finally. And look how thick it is. It's thin. Look how strong that was. You know what is fascinating for me about something like this? Is that as hard as that is, and as pretty as this is, as structured as this is, this was all made by an organism from the grass that it eats. I mean, can you handle it? I just find it being crazy. I love this sort of thing. This is what spins my boat, is finding things like this and trying to understand it. Why this shape? Why these colors? Why so hard? Why so big? How did it get to do it? Where is it getting all this calcium from, this potassium and calcium from, that it's making the shell from? Is it in grass? How does grass get it? You know, a million questions are flying my mind at the moment, and I don't have answers for all of them. Probably why I'm so distracted from time to time. Now, I've noticed something there that I want you to come and have a look at. It's a very pretty caterpillar, and there it is. And one of the iconic caterpillars of the area. You can put him there, and then I'll move out of the way so that you can see him. So that's a dice moth caterpillar. And from the dice moth caterpillar to something that will run away. Enjoy, we'll come back. We'll wait here for you.
So we've just found a little bush buck here lying under the grass and sheltering. We had some questions earlier about sheltering from the rain and the wind, and that's precisely how animals do it. Just like us, they find a little piece of thick bush. You can see he's protected from behind because the tree will block any potential attack, and he's looking out towards where any possible threat could come from. And that's a little bush buck. They're not very common around here. And before I carry on with the bush buck, I must just say that I believe you've been looking at a dice moth caterpillar with Steph. And I was looking at them yesterday. I was actually studying them in my book and thinking, gee, I hope I see one of those soon, because I have seen one or two. But how incredibly wonderful. I'm very jealous that you've been looking at them. And they're the most beautifully colored little caterpillars. Incredible. And the moths are also very pretty, kind of golden with dice dots on them. So a bush buck like this is very closely related to the Nyala and the Kudu. And he is the smallest member of the Tragelaphid or spiral-horned antelope family. Very cleverly got himself into a position where he can shelter from the wind and be away from any potential threats. The wind is still blowing, but there's a bit of sun out now, you can see, and Brian and I were just saying how lovely it is to have that sun on our faces. I think it's going to keep blowing, sort of. I think these gaps in the cloud blow over and then close up again throughout the day as quite a strong southeast seems to be picking up. They eat mainly browse, do the bushbuck, slightly lower down than the Nyala and the Kudu. And he'll be sitting there chewing his cud as well. Right, so from the uncommon bushbuck, we're now heading sort of around towards the Gallagher waterhole and then towards Juma Dam again. This was the area that those lions popped out of. And I don't know what they were doing here, how long they were here, or if they found anything, because of course it rained yesterday. So firstly, we didn't spend a huge amount of time out here. And secondly, the rain would also have obliterated their tracks on the road. So we wouldn't have seen a huge amount in the way of tracks. So whether they were here the whole of yesterday or not, I don't know. Certainly a lot of the rangers wouldn't have gone out in the morning because of that sort of driving Scotch mist, if you like, that eventually turned into quite a substantial shower. But in the afternoon people went out, I don't recall there being any lions found. The wild dogs we were looking for yesterday evening apparently eventually ended up just south of our boundary. So they didn't hang around too long where we were looking for them. There's a nice thing about a day like today, when the sun does pop out, things will generally come out and stand in the sun. And as soon as the sun did come out, while you were with Steph looking at that caterpillar, the birds immediately started to sing. The pinniers, the sunbirds, and the odd robin started to call as the sun bathed them in a little bit of light. They started to yell. I think that's probably because it feels a bit more like morning. I'm not sure why they would not. I don't know why they don't call when it's a bit dull and windy. Checking carefully on the road. We're just checking around for tracks, see if those other two lionesses aren't around. And while we're doing that, Country Girl Ash, you want to know why it is that I became a ranger and why did I decide to do what I'm doing? The short answer to it is that I've always wanted to live in a beautiful place from the time I was little, and I grew up in Johannesburg, which is not a distinctly beautiful place, but it has elements of wilderness outside it that are very pretty. And my various wild places as a child certainly gave me the feeling that I wanted to live in a beautiful place. I didn't always want to be a guide by any stretch of the imagination, and I certainly didn't necessarily hyena tracks. I didn't necessarily want to learn about all the birds and the trees. It was simply a question of wanting to connect with the earth in a pretty place. I just felt happiest in a beautiful place surrounded by nature. So that's the short answer. The longer answer is for a different time, I feel. But that's basically why. Being a guide, of course, is an excellent way of spending your time in the bush. It's a really nice chance, opportunity to live in a place like this. And working for Wild Earth, of course, is even better because, well, you've got so many more guests sitting on the back of the Land Rover every day. And you can try new things and do different things. And you get such an incredible variety of comment and question because you presenting to so many more people than if you've just got six on the back of your car, which is just great. Well, I don't see any further lion tracks. I'm really interested in what happened. As Edward has pointed out, the wild dog policy at the moment seems to be to run through Juma as quickly as possible. Edward, it does feel a little bit like that, but it's not unusual because they have such enormous areas that they like to cover. And as the water becomes a little bit less on Juma and is perhaps a bit more on Biffle's Hook, so the wild dogs will concentrate around water simply because it's easier for them to find animals that are trying to eat. At least trying to drink. Now, when we saw those lions, we had chatted earlier in the day, we were going down the southern boundary towards the Cheetah Cut Line. We were talking about the Guhuma Pride and where they are and the fact that they haven't been around too much and the fact that there doesn't seem to be a male coalition actually visiting Juma on a regular basis. Those Silala Pride are roaming very far at the moment. They're from sort of northern Londolozi. They go into Arethusa, which is off in the southwest. Ooh, blustery wind. They go into the south, into Arethusa, which is west of us, and they come up towards the gate, and then they come across here into Biffle's. And this is in Guhuma Pride territory. They've got no business being here. Again, the rain has come, it's washed away the smell of lions, and those Nkuhumas are not marking territory at the moment. And so it makes it feel like, to many of the other lions, that this is a totally lion-free kind of empty area. So I think that's why those guys are moving in and around here. They're probably also being affected by those Matimbas. The Matimbas are still around. They come into Londolozi and into Malamala every so often. So they're still around there, possibly causing havoc, and maybe that's why the Salalas are trying to sort of avoid that area. I don't know, it's all rather fascinating. Right, we're at the waterhole here. I still don't see any lion tracks. So I think we'll probably pack in that little search, and we'll head to the more central parts of Juma. Let's have a quick look at the weather here coming in, and you can get an idea of the cloud banks that are rolling in here. So it's all quite bright and nice now, but if you look off to the west there, towards the final control, that's underneath that aerial that you can see. You can see a huge bank of grey clouds. And it looks like it's moving away, but the cloud does kind of swirl around. It might come back, it might not. You can hear the wind blowing. It's quite exciting weather, I must say. At least we know the rains are eventually going to start once this kind of weather starts to come through here. We should get some proper rain at some stage. Right. Continue down this road. Most pleased to have Jigger back working. Right, while we're searching down this road, Steph has something yet more interesting to show you. We'll head across to him and I'll continue down this path.
actually running away?
Yeah, it's still there.
So as myself and Andrew were walking up the road, we found ourselves quite far away from the car. We stopped next to this branch, and on it was a squirrel. And have a look over my shoulder over there. The squirrel hasn't decided to run away from us. He's actually sitting on the branch, and we're probably about 7 or 8 feet from that squirrel at the moment. Probably as fascinated with us as what we are with him. Completely relaxed, and just watching us. Isn't it fantastic that we can do that? Now, we were just remarking on how much fun we've actually had on this walk today. We decided to meander through this block, and it's actually been one fascination after another. And I must just say thank you to the entire team for working so hard in making sure that we can bring this type of experience to you wherever you are in the world. To be unencumbered and untethered on foot out here is one of the greatest pleasures of my career so far. It's really such an amazing thing to do. And I just have to do a big shout out to everyone who does it, makes it possible. And then, of course, a big shout out to everyone at home for your support. Without your support, without your questions, without your interest in what we're doing, we wouldn't be able to do you as well. And Wendy in Nebraska has asked, how do I keep myself or my burrs on foot, which is quite a bizarre question there. I'm quite dirty at the moment. What I've done is haven't managed to brush off any of that aardvark hole digging experience that I've done. Andrew and I have been crashing through the bush. I'm actually bleeding in quite a few places from bashing the last couple of minutes. Andrew's managed to fall off of a termite mound today. He doesn't look like he's actually not... doesn't seem to be bleeding anywhere. But the answer about how do I keep my bearings is quite a good one. I look at the sun this time of the day. The sun rises in the east and sets in the west. And at this time of the day, we have the sun over the east. So that's east. I will also use aspect. So I will use the lay of the land. And I know that we are walking on west-facing slopes because the signal with the pack seems to be best on west-facing slopes. And then just by keeping the sun and the aspect and my general knowledge of this area, I'll be able to keep my bearing. And I know that the vehicle is somewhere in that direction. So we're going to cut into this block here soon, and we're going to come out, and I'll probably come out within 100 or 200 meters by 300 yards of the vehicle, if I were to judge it on my past ability to find cars. On that note, I would just like to say thank you from myself and Andrew. We've really enjoyed taking you out on a walk with us today, and I'm sure I'll be seeing a lot more of you on safari over the next couple of days and weeks. Looking forward to it, and we'll definitely catch up with you a bit later.
Sitting on the ground, the most glorious bird of the winter, certainly, and possibly the summer as well, a gorgeous lilac-breasted roller. Look at him there. There he goes. And he'll be quite nervous to fly around, I have to tell you. In a wind like this, he'll be... Ooh. Ryan, do you smell that?
Mm-hmm. I did indeed.
I think we've discovered where the lions came from. Ooh, that is violent. That is a deeply violent smell. I don't know where it's coming from. I think, you know what I probably did? I think that it's simply that I probably drove over some of their droppings earlier today, and now it's stuck on the tire. That's really a bit of a problem. We're going to keep driving a little, quite slowly, to avoid stopping and smelling it again. Clearly those lions were around, possibly around the Juma Dam at some stage, and we rode over their dung. So, lilac-breasted roller, and one of the most unusual birds because it's so colourful and so is the female, and there are very few birds like that.
The
They stay, of course, throughout the winter time. And in the winter, when everything else has lost its great, beautiful summer plumage or gone off overseas, so it is that the lilac-breasted roelap retains that wonderful, wonderful colour. In the winter, it's often quite a nice relief to see him. Oh, interestingly, there was a woodland kingfisher spotted, not here, but up on the high veld the other day. And so I'm expecting the to arrive at any second now. So they are in the country, they just haven't come down to the Kruger National Park yet. And they're intra-African migrants, and that means that they migrate into the northern reaches of Africa, probably around the equator as well, during outer months. So I'm hoping this is a mongoose. Get him there. He thinks we can't see him, you see. He's just come out of his little mound, one of those chimney stack mounds, so not the big ones. There he goes, disappearing off. The smallest carnivore. I'll show you where he came out of. There, another one there. Same little mound there. Now, what we're most used to seeing, of course, are the big fungus-growing termite mounds. That is a fungus-growing termite, but it's a different kind, called Odontotermes, and they just make the chimneys that come out of the ground. Highly favoured by the dwarf mongoose. This one seems to be calling his friends out. From someone called Pup Equality Machina. Pup Equality Machina, I'm going to call you PEM if I might. It's just easier to remember. Fascinating Twitter handle. You want to know if all the termites around the world that use different kinds of fungus use the same kind of fungus? I would say probably not. In fact, I'd say almost certainly not PEM. And that's because obviously the different funguses that occur around the world are not the same. And I know that there are species of ants I think in South America certainly that use fungus gardens. So it's not only the termites. Remember, termites are not closely related to ants at all. So it's an example of what we call convergent evolution, where different kinds of animals that are not related have come up with the same plans for survival, or evolved the same plans for survival. And the fungus is used because they do not have the enzymes to digest plant material. The fungus does that job for them, and then they eat the fungus. And that's just a fascinating way that the termites here do it. There are two or three species of termites that do it here, and quite a few ant species around the world. That's it for today, Braid Wolf, for this morning. We will see you this afternoon at 4 o'clock. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you, James.
Thank you to Steph and Andrew, and of course Tara and Louise in the final control, and Eugene knocking about on the technical stuff. We'll see you this afternoon. Probably be blustery and chilly as well, but an exciting time of the day. Sorry, I thought we had 30 seconds before. We seem to have another 30 seconds. So I shall waffle on at you again for a little while. Great to see those lions. I'm not sure where they're going to come, whether they'll come back or not. I hope they do. Otherwise, we'll try and find some leopards this afternoon. And we'll see you at 4 o'clock. Bye-bye.